our moral, our narrative, our goal, our platform. Salam Media, our humanity.
And we're moving across now to be joined by Ibrahim Anoba. And he is the acting executive director of African Liberty Organization for Development and an African political economy pundit with Washington, D.C. based Young Voices. Ibrahim, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Good morning.
Yes, and welcome, Jazakallah Khairan, so much for joining us this morning. We want to look at Boko Haram, and we've seen this report, and details obviously are starting to emerge with regard to this ambush in northeast Nigeria, saying that Boko Haram attacked a Nigerian oil team, killing over 50. Just some of the background relating to this incident, then the story that has broken out.
Well, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure. Well, I think for a while, in fact, since the inauguration of President Muhammadu Buhari in 2015, the activities of the Boko Haram insurgents have significantly subsided. This is greatly because of the strategy that the president employed, and which is combined effort with Cameroon, Niger, and Chad, which they call the Lake Chad Basin. I think for a while now, since the president has been away, we've seen a kind of resurgence in the activities of the Boko Haram. First, we had a parcel of attacks, suicide attacks or kidnapping or just some very easy cases of insurgency. But just last week, we had very big warning shot, which was that Boko Haram ambushed a police and military convoy in northeastern Nigeria, which was a very big warning to the military. And just after that, the following week, which was last Tuesday, we had this ambush against an oil exploration team in the northeastern state of Magomeri, which is like 50 kilometers of Borno State. So we've had some kind of warnings before this attack. It's just that the military, with all their might, were very unable to kind of anticipate this kind of big attack that have left over 50 people dead. So it's very unfortunate.
Well, it certainly is unfortunate to see innocent lives being lost. Now, looking at the Boko Haram position, and particularly in northeast of Nigeria, which is oil rich, and does Boko Haram have an interest now in the region as a result of oil?
Well, that's one question on the lips of analysts and politicians, but we have to be very cautious about giving significant answer to that. Well, I think the northeastern part of Nigeria is not a place that is used to oil. I think this oil edict started like I think 2 years ago or some very few years back, and kind of countries like Chad, Cameroon, and Niger have already started activities in oil exploration. But the activities of the Boko Haram in 2014 prompted Nigeria to halt exploration, which the military certified safe, and activities resumed back in 2016. But I cannot say categorically if Boko Haram is exclusively interested in the oil. But, you know, since Boko Haram's mission is to have a caliphate in the northeastern Nigeria, and when you want to have a caliphate, you want to secure full domination of your territory, with Boko Haram is claiming. And if Nigeria is going to be fully exploring oil in that part of the country, then you will say in the next few months, we are going to be seeing heavy machinery and heavy drillings in that part of the country, which means, which kind of solidify the Nigerian government's position in that part of the country. So if Boko Haram is looking at dominating the northeastern Nigeria, having the Nigerian government instituting a kind of oil exploration will be a slap on them. So which you can kind of relate to the attack. So it's a battle of supremacy, a battle of a territorial dominance between the Nigerian government and Boko Haram. Not that Boko Haram is exclusively interested in oil, but you can't actually rule that out, because these days terrorists are kind of being linked to oil importation and oil activity, which we saw with the ISIS in Raqqa. But at this point in time, we can categorically say Boko Haram is exclusively interested in Nigerian oil.
Now, another problem, and I've actually seen, is the criticism that is leveled against the Nigerian government, stating there is a leadership bankruptcy on the part of the Nigerian government in dealing with some of these challenges, particularly challenges like Boko Haram and radicalization.
Well, I think at this point in time, because of the casualty, because Boko Haram has killed over 20,000 people and displaced up to like 2.7 million. So we can't just put words under the mouth. We must say it out as it is. I think the Nigerian government recently has been very lethargic in their response to the Boko Haram activities. Though the vice president has called on the military chiefs, including the Naval chief staffs, or chief of army staffs, to move to the ground zero, the heat zone, which is Borno State. But the movement of these army chiefs to Borno State can only have minimal effect if the politicians, the acting president, the Senate president, and every key politicians in Nigeria continue to be embroiled in flimsy political battle. At this point in time, we are kind of witnessing a kind of backstage scuffle between the presidency and the Senate leadership. In fact, within the Senate itself, there is a supremacy battle between the Senate president and member of the House. So the Nigerian political landscape is highly bastardized. And I can't fully blame the acting president, because one, he's not a military trained personnel, which you can kindly understand considering the enormity of the situation. But at the same time, that does not feeling for the unprecedented level of attack by Boko Haram. But one thing is that if you want to counter insurgency, your political landscape has to be unified. That is what we've seen with pulling back of ISIS in places like Iraq, and curbing the activities in some part of the Middle East. So the Nigerian landscape is not favoring the fight against Boko Haram.
Ibrahim, just to understand some of the other developments around the world, and particularly the Middle East region, how has that influenced Boko Haram, its involvement in Nigeria, and also the greater political landscape in Nigeria? How has all of this impacted on Nigeria?
Well, normally, terrorist activities across the world have influenced one another. At some point in time, Boko Haram pledged allegiance to ISIS, which we expected. But I'd say the near defeat of ISIS in Raqqa, and the kind of subsided activities of heavy terrorist attacks in some part of the world recently, in the last probably 1 month or two, has not actually inspired Boko Haram in any way. But I can't fully link this, because subsiding activities of terrorism across the world cannot have inspired Boko Haram, because it can only connect if ISIS or Al-Shabaab or other terrorist organizations are winning battles in their countries or in their places of engagement. But this is not the case. So I think it's purely a kind of exploitative action by Boko Haram, because there is a gap in the Nigerian leadership now. The president is not at home. There is no 100% view in the military presently, because just some months ago we had this fear of military intervention in politics. So a military that is lacking will, and a country that is not having the president for about 2 months. So that's a big gap for terrorists to exploit. So I think it's a case of pure exploring chances, not a case of influence, so to speak.
Now, just looking at this economically, because when one looks at Nigeria looking to find a new oil reserve and looking to the northern part of Nigeria and considering where Nigeria is at this point in time economically and the economic challenges that Nigeria is facing, what does this actually mean economically for Nigeria?
Well, it's a big economic blow, I have to be very honest. Because, you know, the international oil market has been fluctuating for some time now. And the revenue of the Nigerian government has been greatly affected, which prompted the exploration in the northeastern Nigeria. But if this exploration would not go on in the nearest future, it means our major source of income, which is oil, which forms over 90% of our annual budget, will be greatly affected, because the activities of the Niger Delta militants in the Niger Delta is greatly affecting exploration activities in that area. We've had a vandalization of pipelines, kidnapping of oil workers, and the likes, which is reducing the full maximization of the potentials in the north, in the south. But I think one thing is that probably this is a reality check, reality call on Nigeria to effectively diversify the economy. Because you cannot continue to depend on one commodity. And this is what happens when you solely depend on one commodity, especially when it's commodity like oil. So I think the economic impact will be felt, because at this point, we are much struggling economically. We are in recession, and the government is looking for money to finance its upcoming budget. So I think the next 3 months will be very interesting economically.
Well, certainly, and we will be watching Nigeria, because what happens in Nigeria does impact on Africa in general as well, considering when we look at Nigeria, one of the powerhouses on the African continent economic-wise, or the same as South Africa as well. So that is another factor as well, Ibrahim.
Yes, exactly. I mean, Nigeria has a very big economic influence in Africa, even as Nigerians presently relegate that fact, because an economy in shambles cannot be the giant of Africa. But the reality is Nigeria has a great economic impact. So we can only pray that this activity gets to be very, very much addressed in time. But I don't think that that's going to be the case. Because I'm not kind of being negative here, but the reality is the country needs very straightforward leadership, and the acting president has his hand full. We have the agitations of Biafrans in the southern part of Nigeria, which is causing massive headache. We are having secessionist activities in some other places. Now you have Boko Haram. That is too much for the acting president, who is under political propaganda, political ambush from his own team and, you know, the opposition party. It's too much for him to handle. So hopefully the president will be back soon. And if his health will not allow him, which we pray he should allow him, but some Nigerians will at least agree anyway. But we hope he comes back soon and, you know, this country can have a good and straightforward leadership.
Well, Ibrahim, we're going to have to leave it at that. As always, we certainly do appreciate your time with us, and we wish you all the best.
Thank you for having me, sir. It's a pleasure.